This is Off Planet Radio.
Somewhere in the western United States, and we are going to have a conversation today on a number of subjects. Okay, it's kind of an open topic today. You sent me a video that detailed troop activities in the West, and we'll probably just go ahead and put that video out with this. So anything you want to tell us about updates on the security state of inland America?
You don't think the country's at war. We're seeing military everywhere. South Dakota going west. These things go for miles, some of them. Robin says these are military police battalions. Retired staff sergeant. 235th Military Police Battalion. We passed about a mile of them before I turned the camera on. Armored Humvees with bulletproof glass. Look real close at the windows. Yeah, so all is not right at home in America. Thank all the criminals in Washington. And a bunch of idiot yes men in the military that don't really give a shit about their oath. Alright, I'll videotape some more later.
Yeah, the people, for the most part, I've been interviewing people wherever I camp, which has been over 20 locations in 4 weeks. I started out in Oklahoma, southwest Oklahoma, a half hour north of the Texas border. And the military movements there were orders of magnitude more than what they are out west. But the people seem, for the most part, oblivious, because I would interview people at the campgrounds, although off the record, none of them wanted to be on videotape. And then I headed back to Arkansas, rested up for a couple days, and put together some more money and headed west. I went to Montana, right there on the border of Idaho. And on the way out here, I seen the giant military police battalions, which would make sense if they're going to this JADE HELM 15 situation in a live kind of format. In other words, from what Colonel Potter says, if you look up Colonel Potter's interviews on YouTube and you read the Army Field Manual, they're talking about arresting dissenters of the government, no different than that of Adolf Hitler's Germany or Joseph Stalin, etc., from what I can tell. You still got me there?
I'm here, man. I'm still here.
Okay.
Okay.
So, but the people, for the most part, seem oblivious to anything that's going on. I tried to educate them on our situation in Texas, where Obama declared Texas a hostile territory. And I seen the military going south, huge battalions, every kind of military asset you can think of going south. As I came up north from Arkansas, you have to drive through Missouri, and then you finally you get to Iowa, then you go west on 90 to go out west. And the level of military was obviously for war. It wasn't for anything else, because you don't put those kind of assets in motion unless you're intending to use them. And so it made sense that Texas demanded the repatriation of their gold, the Fed Reserve, and basically the federal government told them, you know, no. And so that there's been a war declared between Texas and the federal government. Texas brought in Vladimir Putin's military, so now we have Russian battalions of battleships off the coast of the Gulf of Mexico, off the coast of Texas. I'm not sure how many at this point, but it's quite a few in international waters there. And as well as there's Chinese troops, which shows China and Russia are you know, buddy-buddy. Because why would China come into Texas in such a massive... there's 50,000 Chinese MRAPs, for example, a little bit west of Dallas and Fort Worth in their training. So, yeah, we have our own Ukraine going on right here in America, and I didn't talk to one single person who's aware of it. Not one.
Yeah, I've been hearing reports as well of... Russian troops and Canadian troops on the northern borders, I believe up around Idaho.
Yep. And in Michigan, Alpena, if you look up Alpena, that's a there's Russian assets being staged there as well. So the people that represent us as supposedly public servants that were supposedly voted in have betrayed us on such a level that, you know, there are no words except for treason and sedition or whatever you want to add to the legal soup there. These people are criminals of the highest order, and the fact that the general public is not aware that they're on the hair's breadth trigger of destruction. What are the Americans going to do? I'm sitting here right now at a gas station using you know, their Wi-Fi. I'm looking at a BMW, a Nissan, another Nissan pickup truck, all kinds of fancy cars and trucks. What are these Americans going to do that don't give a damn when they don't have gasoline for their toys? How do you think they're going to behave? You know, people better start asking themselves this question, because they're most Americans, I'd say 95%, are going to be caught totally unaware with their pants down, and suddenly they don't have fuel for their toys, for their trucks, their cars, no on-time food delivery. I mean, what was it? I'm trying to think of the guy that predicted this. He's a famous soothsayer, if you will. Yeah, you probably know him better than I do, Randy. You're far more advanced in those kind of studies than I'll ever be. But he's 16th century or 15th century.
Nostradamus?
Yeah, he said that this would be the most violent time in history before a golden age would set in, kind of that effect, you know. And I'm starting to see how that can be very truthful.
Well, nearly every prophetic system predicts that. The Book of Revelation, the Mayan teachings on the Kali Yuga. We pretty much live in the cradle of all of these things right now, Stephen.
Yes, sir. Yep. And I've listened to you talk about it for years, and you and Chris and George Ann Hughes and of course numerous really famous people that you've interviewed, and it's all sadly coming to fruition, but I believe it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. And I've said this before on numerous little shows, and that, you know, if we all focused on something positive, well, we would have a positive outcome. But because we've chosen to focus on the negative and focus on Armageddon instead of better education and better food, well, the people are getting what they put their energy into, in my opinion, you know.
Yeah.
It's disturbing. It's very depressing. Because I, you know, nobody wants to see this. It's in their right mind. I met two of the dumbest people I've ever met in my life out west here 2 days ago here in the Black Hills National Forest. Young couple, and they were camping and driving a real fancy Ford vehicle. And I said, and you know, they were close enough, you know, they could hear me talking to my dog. And I waved at him. I said, hi. I said, do you mind if I get your opinion on, you know, different things going on in the world? And the young man said, no, I guess not. So I said, how old are you guys? Because you look pretty young. And he was 25 and his girlfriend was 23. And this is the country we live in, what I'm fixing to tell you. I said, well, what do you think about Fukushima? You know, these three reactors that went supercritical, and now the Pacific Ocean is dying. And he just grinned and he goes, well, it's not as bad as what they're making it out to be. He goes, I'm a high school teacher and I teach physics. I said, oh, okay, that's good. We can go there. What do you think about Common Core education? You know, well, the math, it's not as bad as what they're saying it is. I mean, this guy is just apologizing for everything. I said, okay, so what was wrong with the old system of math? If you take a math test from the 1700s, you couldn't pass it. I don't know anybody that could pass it. From the 7th grade, you couldn't pass it. 7th grade math test, 1700s, late 16th century. I said, pull it up on your computer and let me see you take the math test and pass it. So how is it good that they've degenerated our math to what it is in Common Core? And he said, well, it's not as bad as what they're making it out to be. It's just making it easier for them. I said, well, when you make stuff easier, your brain isn't functioning. This kid was liberal. It was obvious. I said, well, what do you think about 9/11? Because you said you teach physics. Well, how do you explain buildings coming down from basically low-grade, you know, kerosene? That doesn't happen, my friend. Never in history has fire brought down a skyscraper. So, you know, how do you explain that? And then he goes, well, this conversation's going to have to end because we're going to have breakfast. I said, okay, I understand where you're going with this. You're walking around and dancing around a very important topic because you haven't given it any thought. I said, let me suggest this. Look up Building 7. You're a physicist. And tell me how Building 7 came down. And he said, Building 7, what's that? I said, Steve, you know, you're not being very honorable, acting like you know something about a situation and you don't seem to have a clue about it. Because if you don't know about Building 7 and the other four buildings that came down, there's seven buildings total were destroyed. Did you know that? Because no, I'm going to have to do some more research on it. I said, yeah, because ever since that day, our country spiraled into a police state and martial law. And, you know, tons of aggressive wars, which are illegal, murdering millions of people. And you just want to act like it doesn't matter. And it does matter. And he goes, okay, I'll research that. And, you know, thank you, and blah, blah, blah. But his girlfriend just had this, you know what, eat and grin on her face the whole time. I was thinking of the Bible scripture that said, in the end, you know, that they shall become lovers of themselves and arrogant and haughty. And that's exactly where we are. As long as they have their piece of the fascist pie, people don't give a damn, Randy. That's the problem. That's what's going on. You know, as long as I got my truck and gasoline's fairly cheap and I can go to McDonald's on the weekend or whatever, I don't care how much suffering's going on. And that's the problem with the human family. And it's taken me years to get out of this denial in my own head that there's still got to be some decent people. And that took me right back to the Bible again. When he said, well, let me just find one good person in Babylon, you know, before, you know, Yahweh scraped them off the surface of the planet, and you couldn't find one good person. I'm starting to.
That was actually Sodom.
I'm sorry.
Even worse. We're Mystery Babylon. You know, I've concluded studying the scriptures since I was a kid and looking at the present milieu of the United States. It's an aggregate identity, but we are Mystery Babylon in the Bible. We are the financial system, and it goes into, I think, Revelation 13 listing, you know, all of these commodities, and the very last line, it goes in the souls of men. And that is the real product of Mystery Babylon, is the enslavement of the souls of men through the beast system, the beast computer, the beast number system. I mean, hey, look, you know what? We can't apologize for talking about this stuff because it's right on our backs now. I mean, you know, 10 years ago, we would have thought to have been lunatics. Well, I was considered to be a lunatic. And now we're looking at it head on. And we aren't even seeing the 2 million pound dragon in the middle of the room.
Exactly. Yeah. And that being said, this is the area of Sturgis, South Dakota, where I'm at now. I'm just over the border in Wyoming, and you know, the millions of bikers. Okay, so I just had a heyday talking to these bikers, because you know, these are the guys that were supposed to be protesting the war in the 60s and 70s. They were supposed to be, you know, demanding civil rights, but they were too stupid and uneducated and illiterate to even read the law. Okay. And I didn't mean to jump off into law, but this is kind of hand in hand with our problem, because what did Adolf Hitler do? I'm sorry. What did Adolf Hitler do? He made everything legal that he was doing. So it was in writing. Well, the law says, you know, I can ask for your papers. Well, the law says you need a license, to move around, to travel, to have what they call right of way in law, okay, which is all baloney, okay? You don't need a license. That falls under U.S. Coast Guard 23 Code of Federal Regulations, okay? It clearly says what the licensing's for. And then licensing started under under Title 50, under the, sorry, I'm doing this off the top of my head, under Title 50, Trading with the Enemy Act, you had to be licensed if you wanted to do business, okay? That was 1917. And then the Emergency Banking Act, or the Mandatory Act, or I'm trying to remember the Executive Order 6111. This just enforced this fascist takeover by banks. If people don't read the law, and then you get to the Civil Rights Act, okay, of 1866, And it tells you, well, if you want remedy, you have to go back to this act in 1863 and all this baloney. But then when you start reading what civil rights are under 42 U.S. Code Section 1981, that you should be subject to all penalties, taxes, and exactions, okay, of every kind, it says. And well, an exaction is the police officer tasing you and saying, give me your money. It's worse than extortion. It's a higher level crime and extortion, okay? So people out there demanding their civil rights in Washington and Times Square or wherever, yeah, well, they're giving you your civil rights. It's right in law. Well, you want your civil rights? Okay, send out the riot squad, you know, and tear gas those people and hit them with the hoses. And, yeah, that's your civil rights, people. Learn to read the law. The destruction of your country is in writing. It's right there. It's not a conspiracy theory. It's a fact.
So this whole thing, yeah, back in the 60s with Martin Luther King and the civil rights movement, that was all basically emerging out of the 14th Amendment. Is that correct?
Yeah. Because they had to see the whole thing, what people don't understand, the 14th Amendment, they vacated those offices when they incorporated in 1871. So you had the Reconstruction Act of 1867, 1867. You had the 14th Amendment, 1868. Then you had the Organic DC Act of 1871, known as the Act of 1871. Well, The Act of 1871 vacated all the government offices under the 14th Amendment and installed associations and corporations and, you know, fictitious entities, which put them in a subservient position because it was a lower position than government official. So now, by law, you don't have any lawfully elected people because the Constitution's only in effect on election day from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. for 12 hours. And once election day is over, the Constitution is back under the emergency state of emergency. Oh, Lord, it just slipped my mind.
The War Powers Act.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
So it's all a big fraud on the people. And here's your remedy in court. First of all, if you go to court, plan on losing. These people are corrupt, and they know that they're going to be hung under the Lieber Code. Under international treaties and international law, these are human rights violations. They're war crimes. They're crimes against humanity. They're warring against the Constitution. They're overthrowing a constitutional form of government. So all these people, from the lowest to the highest, and if you watch the World War II tribunal, I tell people you better watch Nuremberg or listen to it at least an hour and a half. The Nuremberg trials. Watch this stuff because that's what's coming for you, Mr. Teacher, that's teaching nonsense and communism and teaching that children don't have rights. Mr. Police Officer, Mr. Lawyer, okay, from the lowest to the highest in the Nuremberg, they were sentenced and they were tried on crimes against humanity, war crimes, crimes against peace. I said, and the same thing's going to happen in America on a far bigger scale. So when you go to court, these people are committing war crimes. And why is it a war crime? Because you took an oath under Article 6, Clause 3, the United States Constitution, to protect the people, that's us, from the belligerents. And who are the belligerents? That's the guy that's doing interstate commerce. That's one state doing commerce with another state, commerce. Interstate commerce is the truck driver doing business under license with the state he's in. And that these are the belligerents, okay? The corporate fascists, basically, the banks. Those are the belligerents. They're under licensure, okay? These are the belligerents, and they took an oath to protect us from the belligerents. When they violate that oath, that's perjury. And because, you're acting in a fashion of warring against a constitutional form of government, that's a war crime. That's treason, okay? Treason is a war crime. That's why it's a war crime. So when you go into any court, what people don't understand, your paperwork's not going to be accepted as legitimate unless, you know by now, Randy, but I'm always, if I get more time to think about stuff, I'll get it all right because it's all in the back of my head half the time. Get your paperwork notarized. Never file an affidavit unless you're, charging against somebody else or something like that, because an affidavit means you're under oath or affirmation, and if they decide you're lying, well, you just put yourself in jeopardy. So you just file a free will act, they call it. You're just filing a free will act saying, listen, if anybody who's putting a charge against my property, which is all capital letter name Stephen John Miller, it needs to be done under oath or affirmation with two witnesses, okay, and then you get that notarized. Then in your courts in Pennsylvania, I believe you go to the Court of Common Pleas, to the clerk, in other words, the notary's boss, and have them stamp it too. Then you have two seals. Now you've opened a court of record, okay, common law. Then when you go into the court for your hearing, when they call your name, you stand up and say, on and for the record, I accept all the oaths of the officers of this court and bind them to it, as I remind you all of your fiduciary duties, as I extend you my self-governing immunity while you carry out my wishes. Okay? On and for the record, I am a spirit-filled living man or woman here in the presence of God and created by God, or however you wish to word that part. Now, when you say on and for the record, you just turn that court into an Article 3 court. Now they can't touch you, and your paperwork's done properly. Just rewind the show and listen to it, and you're good to go. And it's really that simple. They can't touch you unless they have a tort action, T-O-R-T, like tortoise. Unless they have a tort action, which means they have a third-party witness to you harming another individual. Now, don't use the word individual or person, but man or woman. Yeah. So if you read Bouvier's Law, type into your computer books of authority, okay? And books of authority, when used in court, are the law. And that would be Bouvier's or Blackstone's. I studied under Sir William Blackstone's Institute. So these are books of authority, and the internet will tell you if these books are used in your case, they are the law. You will win. So that's what I go by.
What about Black's Law Dictionary? Because we've got a bunch of editions of those out there.
Yeah, I mean, Black's Law, past the fifth edition, Black's Law removes the Constitution, and I would just avoid Black's Law except for educational purposes.
Okay.
I mean, it's good. I mean, it talks about fiduciaries and all that kind of stuff, and it talks about contracts and deeds. But the oath is a deed. It's a public deed. That's what an oath is. So when you say I accept your oath, okay, that deed is now in effect, and they can't get out of it. They're in trouble now because you accepted their oath. Let me see if I can pull that up in my notes here. But I've been going against these people, you know, at the International Tribunal for Natural Justice, which is the world court, and because I'm fed up with their nonsense. An oath is a common law deed, okay? These are just my definitions of an oath. An oath, a promissory oath, okay? A promissory note is a deed. Once you accept an oath of the person that took the oath, that deed is executed by the grantee, okay? I mean, by the grantor. The people are the grantees, okay? The judge, any officers of the court, these would be grantors, okay? And once you accept their oath and that deed is executed, now they're working to protect you again from the belligerents. And that's a problem. So when you go in there and you say, honored for the record, I accept the oaths, you know, of all officers of this court, honorable magistrate, do not call him judge. Because once you call him judge and recognize him as the judge, now he's going to say, well, okay, well, based on my, judgment, I'm just going to let you stew on this. In other words, he can just keep putting it off and putting it off and putting it off and tire you out until you give up, okay? Because they're psychos. They don't care. They don't want to. Psychopaths never can admit they're wrong. The rules don't apply to them. So you don't want to ever make them judge. Honorable magistrate is fine. Administrator is fine. You want that on and for the record. Now you just created a common law court of record. That's not just me talking. That's Bill Thornton talking, who I subscribe to a lot of his stuff. And the Nitty Gritty Law School. Look up the Nitty Gritty Law School on YouTube if you don't mind spending 12 hours taking notes. So there's a lot of pertinent stuff there. Can't think of that. You know, that's what I did, dude. I just took, you know, I've got three briefcases packed to the brim on the codes. And I try to tell people, the codes are not law, okay, and these statutes and stuff. And I can argue that in court very eloquently and win every time, and I'll tell you why. Because I know the history of it, and it blows their mind, okay? But the law says you're not required to have a driver's license or tag, okay? And saying, well, here's your statute, and you're deliberately, intentionally misreading your statutes. The Highway Safety Act, read it, Title 23, Section 1250. Read the Title 23 Code of Federal Regulations 1327. This all comes under United States Coast Guard, and these are for commercial use only. Okay, I am not in commerce. I am not a person, a commercial entity. Now, you see, the burden of proof is on them to prove something to the contrary. So, the chaos doctrine in law. Okay, and I'll get into maxims too, but the chaos doctrine, that's what I use. A little goes a long way. I interject so much controversy in handwriting, though. I don't talk once I get up to the podium. I interject so much controversy, they can't get around it. And they can't get around my paperwork because they know when I hand my paperwork in, I'm now the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court agreed with my paperwork. Now I have a court order from the Supreme Court. That's the power of my paperwork, of having the two stamps. So you get your do your free will act, okay? What you do with any notary and have it just certified, okay? She'll stamp it and before me is sworn and blah, 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 okay? In other words, she looked at your paperwork and your license and verified it too. Okay, I mean certified. Then you go to her boss, the clerk of the court in most states, and they'll have to look for the stamp because nobody ever does that because they never don't know how to do it. And then she'll stamp it, and now you are the Supreme Court. The paperwork you're putting in is a court order, and the court order says what? Okay, if you're bringing any man or woman bringing a charge against my property, known as Stephen John Miller, must be under oath or affirmation and with two witnesses. Okay, that's a court order. That's not just me talking or whatever. That is actually a court order with the same power as the Supreme Court. And they can't get around that. Now, when I go into court and stand at the, they call my name and I say, on and for the record, I accept the oaths of all officers of this court as I bind you to them and remind you of your fiduciary duties, as I extend you my self-governing immunity, okay, as you carry out my wishes, and honorable magistrate, see, now you just appointed him honorable magistrate. He's no higher than that. He can't hear your case as a judge. He can't sit there and say, well, I'm going to postpone this for 6 months. Because they will. They'll postpone it. They'll reschedule. Blah, and they'll do that until they wear you out so bad you'll take a plea deal. They can't do that to me because I gave them a court order. They don't have any choice. They have to. So it's going to say, you know, either put somebody on the stand under oath or affirmation with two witnesses, with a proper affidavit, okay, read the definition of affidavit under Bouvier's law or Blackstone's, okay? It's basically what you believe. I'm not doing an affidavit here. I'm just saying, understand the definitions. An affidavit goes on a form called a jurat, okay, G-U-R-A-T. It's called a jurat, okay? You don't need that. And that's where people get confused. You don't want to do an affidavit because you're putting yourself in jeopardy if you get something wrong. You just want to do a free will act, okay? Also known as a free will act and deed, but there's no deed here. So it's just free will act. And you're putting that before the court with two stamps, okay? And once she verifies that her notary is legitimate, that's your second stamp, the clerk of the court, they can't touch you. They're done. You just gave them a court order. It says, you better have somebody with an affidavit that's charging my all capital letters name. That's my property. You better have somebody with two witnesses. If you don't, this needs to be discharged post haste. And guess what? They don't have anybody that's going to take the stand under oath or affirmation with two witnesses under an affidavit. And so the only other choice they have is discharge, and that's the order. So that's how it works in a nutshell. You can give people my email address or just Stephen64@Hushmail, just like it sounds, Stephen64, the year I was born, @Hushmail.com. I can get into a lot more detail, but it's really that simple. But I never seem to get that far. I don't have all my notes, and frankly, a lot of times I'll do interviews and I'm not up to par, if you will, you know, so. So they're committing war crimes because they're using threats and extortion and coercion, and they're using codes against you. And I was getting into that. I apologize.
Go ahead.
About the codes. That's the Trading with the Enemy Act, 1917. So that's, you know, only use a jurat or affidavit if you are filing against someone. Use an acknowledgement to rebut presumptions, like I just told you a minute ago. So you're rebutting their presumption, and by putting in this acknowledgement the way I told you to do it, And you're saying you need to have somebody under oath or affirmation with an affidavit and two witnesses. But don't use a jurat or an affidavit unless you're putting charges on somebody. But let me see right here. I'm sorry, I got to do reading glasses because I can't see. You know how they say that? Can't see, you know what?
Well, it's okay. It's not video, so you're good.
Oh, okay, good. Yeah. Yeah. And you got that right. Okay, I'm sorry. Yeah. Oh, I'm looking this up, Randy. I mean, what's your situation out east there in Pennsylvania? Are the people starting to get a clue?
The activity here is largely logistics, increased traffic coming in and out of depots and things like that. We're not seeing a lot on the ground. I'm told that back in late April, early May, we had a fair amount of traffic, which would make sense. Where I live here in southern Pennsylvania, it's a logistics hub. You have Naval Supply Depot and the Army Depot, both of which are located here. So this area is largely logistics because it's the hub for the Northeast transportation system. So we're not seeing military occupational forces as such. Now, I was shown photographs in early July by people who had traveled through West Virginia that had brown signs that had closed. These would have been Army signs closing an interstate, which is within the purview of the military to do because the interstate highway system was created by Eisenhower as a military transportation system, modeled on the German highway
system. Autobahn,
yeah. Based on the Autobahn system. Eisenhower had seen that in Germany. He was impressed by it. So it appears as though there was and probably still is limited activity here. But the West appears to be the place they need to lock down right now. They've got two major assets in the West, Texas and California, two regions, basically. Ancillary to that's all the other Western states as well. But the core region being first Texas and second California because of the federal assets deployed in those areas and the fact that, first off, Texas historically has been a republic. Texas is rather unique in that regard. And Texas is getting very itchy about the situation. They have demanded back gold from the depositories in New York through their regents at the University of Texas. So it looks like Texas is trying to make a move right now to possibly, I won't use secede, I will say that they could theoretically set up their own republic.
Yeah, if you read the law they passed a few months ago, that's why they're now at war with the federal government, because in their law, put forth by their legislative body, it says, that their goal will be repatriated and they want nothing more to do with, anything out of Washington, D.C. or the 6.5 miles in Virginia. And here's another remedy, because for you, when they try to use codes against you, and I say anything with a number in front of it doesn't apply to me. And here's why I say that. Number one, it's repugnant to the common law. Okay. It's repugnant to the first 10 amendments of the Bill of Rights. Okay. And as Bill Thornton would say, I'm a king. You had my will while this was being, adhered to by public officials and you were treating me with respect and understanding my rights. But as soon as you started violating my rights, I'm a king. Bouvier's law, Blackstone's. That's the law in any court. And not only in any court in America, that's the law in the world, okay? That's what people don't get. You're talking about international stuff here. What's it say in Bouvier's and Blackstone's? If I remove my will, you cannot force me to abrogate. I mean, you cannot force me to compel and abrogate my rights at that point. Okay, so December 7th, 1925, none of the U.S. codes were passed by both houses. Okay, these were totally, they were just used as administrative policy. They couldn't use them as law. Okay, but they were gonna say, well, okay, well, you can use them as policy, where you get policy enforcement. Okay, so June 26, 1926, the U.S. codes were published. They published them all in one book, Title 1 through Title 51, but that does not make them law. Anybody can publish a book of nonsense. Okay, it doesn't make it legitimate. So remember that too. I mean, see, so I use all this in my acknowledgement, not an affidavit. Get that in your heads, everybody. If you're going to file an affidavit, that's because somebody broke your arm or robbed you or worse, and you have a witness to it, and you're not going to purge yourself. But an affidavit puts you under oath, okay? You swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth. So be very careful with affidavits, because they'll use those against you. An acknowledgement is just saying, hey, you know, here's my voice, and I'm opening up this common law court of record, and the notary just can say, okay, yep, that's Steve Miller, yep, that's his license, and then she stamps it. Then you go to her boss, okay, and that's verifying everything. Then now you have what's called, you don't want anything half. It can't be half proof. It has to be full proof. Okay, once you get the second stamp, that's full proof. Now you've opened a common law court of record, and of course you double up on that in court by saying on the record and for the record. Okay, now it's a common law court, and now it's your court. You are the court, and the court you're in, that's called this court, okay, because it's one of many. So that's this court that you're in. When you go by what I just told you to do, you've just opened the court, and you've brought your court to these people, and that's a court order. So they have to do what you ask them. That you have to go by Blackstone's advice. I go by what he says, brother, and go by Bouvier's. You go by those two books and research what I'm telling you. You'll never lose another court case again. I don't care if it's a ticket or you know, whatever, a neighbor making a false accusation against you. No, anybody makes a false accusation against me, I'm going to put them on the stand and destroy them, because as soon as they come in the courtroom, I'm going to hand a subpoena to the bailiff and say, hey, would you hand this to the affiant over there? Affiant's, you know, a word for the person who filled out the affidavit against you. And now you're going to subpoena. I'm getting a little bit of echo. You're getting a subpoena to them. And now you can bring them on the stand as a hostile witness, and you can ask them anything you so shall desire. But if you just question them on the stand while the prosecutor's representing them and their attorneys, okay, you have to stick with only the subject matter they allow. So that's why you always subpoena, whoever the affiant is. If it's a police officer, it doesn't matter who it is. You want to subpoena them. Get a blank subpoena form when you walk into court, and have the clerk help you fill it out. They don't mind assisting you. They're allowed to assist. They're not allowed to give you advice, though. So have her assist you in filling it out. And after, when you have your chance to cross-examine these individuals, you hand them the subpoena through the bailiff. And if they deny it, that there you go. You got your hostile witness. If they accept it, you have your hostile witness either way. So they can't win. Now you can ask them anything you want, which is very important. So you put them on the stand and destroy them, and make them and destroy their credibility. That's a reasonable doubt, and they'll throw it out. So, and it's not as hard as it sounds or scary or whatever. And most of the people I've met in the court system are kind people that are just, indoctrinated into the system and brainwashed. And if you just take your time, and they're going to research what you're doing, and it'll scare the hell out of them. So they will start treating you like a king, because you just took over that whole courtroom. If you wanted to, once you file the proper papers and do it with the two stamps, you can fire people. And they know it. So you're going to notice a big change in their attitudes, I can go in there and say, hey, bailiff, arrest the prosecutor, arrest that magistrate. As soon as they're off the bench, tell them to pack their stuff and get the heck out of this public building. They violated their oath under Article 6, Clause 3, which is perjury, and that's an act of treason, and that's a war crime. I want them out of the building by the end of this evening. And they'll do it. They have to. So understanding the law, and it all starts with making your paperwork legitimate. And that's what they're always looking for. And I've never seen one affidavit ever put before the court. It's legitimate. Not one. Not from the police. Not from, somebody just wanting to be a jerk and sue you or claiming you harmed them. Not one affidavit's ever been lawful. So that's your remedy. And learn the codes. If you don't know them, I can send you a whole email of their fraud. I mean, it's called congressional record, okay? And I've got the congressional record in my own handwriting, a couple thousand pages. So when you have that kind of power behind you, when you go to court, you're not going to win. You're not going to lose. They're not going to win against you. There's no way they can touch you. If you pointed out the fraud, you've done your paperwork properly, and that's where we need to go. Now, under martial law, okay, if they declare martial law, everybody should read Title 10 U.S. Code, Section 333. And no, it wasn't passed by both houses, so it's just policy. But it does apply to the administration, and that's why it applies to the administration, because it was never passed to be used against the people. In fact, they had to keep fighting it, trying to get it to use against the people, and they would repeal it and say no. 18 U.S. Code was repealed 3 times. How that happened, I don't know. You can look that up. In other words, it's called statutory fraud, Randy, and that's what they do on people in these courtrooms, because none of the lawyers that are posing as attorneys are even attorneys. Not one of them. They're not attorneys. Because you have to use the name as the Supreme Court. When you take the baby bar test and then you take the bar exam, okay, and you become an attorney, you have to be admitted by the Supreme Court to practice law, okay, within the corporate United States, okay, as a person. Okay, well, the only way they can hear meritorious claims in these courts, which I believe fall under Article 1, because they're definitely not Article 7, right? I mean, if you read Article 7, everything is supposed to be civil. They have no jurisdiction under law or equity, okay? And that's why they won't hear case law, because what's case law? It's the Constitution and it's law. And so this is how these guys work. It's all obfuscation of what's really going on. Well, if the district attorney say, I don't recognize your name. It's not on the official roll of attorneys, in the state capitol or in the Supreme Court of the state. Who are you? Because if I'm admitted to the bar, it would be Stephen John Miller, my lawful name. Okay. If you're admitted to the bar, it'd be Randall, whatever your middle name is, Moggins. Okay. And if you're using, Randall and your middle initial Moggins, that's statutory fraud. And you're using a DBA or you're using an assumed name. And that's a criminal act at very high level. So all they're doing is they're going, here, sign here and I'll represent you. Okay. So in other words, you're giving them power of attorney. Well, anybody can do that. I can give you power of attorney, Randy. So I'm giving you power of attorney, represent my business affairs. And that's all they're doing in these courts. Not one of them are using the name as admitted by the Supreme Court. Okay, not one. So use that against them. Demand to see their articles of association, their articles of incorporation, their 1023, 1024 tax-exempt status and the determination letter as to that status by the IRS. Demand to see their W-9 if it's filed electronically. And you won't even get that far if you just start at the beginning, where I told you to put your acknowledgement in. Somebody needs to be under oath or affirmation with 2 witnesses, or this case needs to be discharged. And put in there anybody putting a charge against my personal property, known as Stephen John Miller, needs to do these things, or this needs to be discharged. I doubt you'll make it past that point. They'll throw it out every time. If they reschedule it, then they're not adhering to the rules of Black Stones and Bouvier. And now you've really got them. Now you go to the administrative process. You contact the governor. You contact the mayor. You contact attorney general and let them know these people are damaging you and you need an administrative hearing so sanctions can be brought against them. Once they deny your administrative hearing, then you can file your federal tort claim, known as the SF tort claim, under Form 95 you can file that charge with the sergeant at arms and then he will waive their immunity and you can own every one of them. That's how it works. But if you don't do the administrative process first, it's not even going to be heard in front of a war crimes tribunal. So it's important to do administrative, because that proves you've exhausted all administrative remedies, Black's Law, Doctrine of Exhaustion of Administrative Remedy, and of course Bouvier's and Blackstone's get much more into detail than Black's Law. And they're much more, they're books of authority. If you look up books of authority in law, the first two you'll see is Blackstone's and Bouvier's as being the only books that matter in any court, okay? So if you're using those books and the stuff I'm telling you that I've learned, you won't lose. And the judges aren't stupid. They're not going to go against somebody that knows what I just told you. So anyway, as far as the people in this country go, we've all been brainwashed to, just believe, Joe, police officer is the law, and that the good old judge is supposed to be there on the bench, even though it's a violation of, it's all kinds of violations. Where do I start? There's not even supposed to be a judge in the courtroom, Article 3, Section 2, Clause 3. Well, why is that? Because a judge is not impartial, okay? An impartial jury shall hear all criminal cases, okay, or controversies arising over $20, which are civil, that falls under the 7th, Article 7. Why is that important?
Go into that for a minute. Go into the civil thing a little bit. Let's talk about what happens with banks, credit card companies, third-party collection agencies and things like that. I mean, you just gave us a whole bunch of information that I suspect is relative to everything I just listed here, but go into that a little bit, the commercial side of this.
Yeah, okay. Civil, I just talked to a man last night, that I'm glad you brought it up, that lost his home. He had 7 years equity in it. He lost his job, got behind. They filed an in absentia hearing, which means he's not present. That's all in absentia means. And they got a summary judgment and moved to evict him because they're psychopaths. They don't want to work with you. Okay. And he lost his home. And I asked him, I'll just give him his first name, Tim. I said, well, dude, did you go to court on this or did you file for a hearing or you should have did something? No, I didn't think it was worth the time. He goes, what would I say? They sent all their attorneys in from Wells Fargo. I said, their attorneys are only allowed to make an opening statement. Past that point, they need to put somebody on the stand, okay, with firsthand knowledge of you with mens rea, which means a guilty mind, conducting an act of malum prohibitum, which means a prohibited act, not paying your bills. Did you do that with a guilty mind? Like, I'm just going to screw these guys? Or did you just honestly couldn't make the payment because you lost your employment? And he goes, oh, no, I lost my employment. I said, okay, well, you're not guilty of anything, okay? And seeing that they sent their attorneys in as grantors, well, you need to put the attorney on the stand, subpoena them right there, and put them on the stand and say, what did you grant me? I want to know what you granted me. Well, we didn't grant you anything. We just assigned credit. It's like, okay, so then you didn't actually have any actual interest in this loan then, did you? What's your actual interest in the loan? The only answer you can give is none. And that's the end of the case. That's all the judge is waiting to hear is what I call a magistrate. Let them be judged, though, when they're helping you. Use the court to your benefit. That's what it's there for. when they're prosecuting somebody on my behalf, let them be whatever the hell they want. But if they're coming on me legally sideways over some moron, then I'm going to tell them what they are. Okay, that's how those courts work. And it's always been that way. Except back to the, you know, Magna Carta, Article 61. So you're going to, that attorney starts speaking over and above the opening statement. Then on January 2nd, you know, Mr. Jones hadn't paid his mortgage in 3 months. And, you know, and our attorney said we needed to move forward with legal action and have him evicted. Okay. That's all he's allowed to say. That's it. Now he can't talk anymore. Okay. And so if he starts speaking again, you object and you have the bailiff hand him that subpoena, because now you're going to cross-examine this bastard since he's not putting anybody up on the stand, is he? Who's he putting up on the stand? You say, I object. The judge is saying, why are you objecting? If he's not going to put somebody on the stand with firsthand knowledge of me with a guilty mind, mens rea, violating a contract, malum prohibitum, then he needs to stop talking. In fact, I would like to cross-examine him as a hostile witness. Here's a subpoena. He's going to reject that subpoena. Now he just forced himself up on the stand. He has to go on the stand. He just made a big mistake. Now you ask him, you have firsthand knowledge of me doing violating this contract, you know, with a guilty mind and purposely trying to defraud you. Well, no, I don't have any firsthand evidence. Okay, well, what are you claiming to grant me here? You're claiming to be grantor? Is that what you're claiming? Then shut up, because you're putting him on in jeopardy of perjury. So if he says, well, yeah, we granted you a loan, that's no, you're not a grantor. A grantor must have, like, if I grant you 7 acres, I better have 7 acres of property to relinquish that that agreement, okay? Or I'm not granting you anything. But see, so what did the bank grant you? They didn't grant you anything. They merely assigned you credit. Now we go into the Bankruptcy Act, and now we're going to fry these bastards, okay? Because they've committed fraud upon the court. Where's the original note? I need to see it. Not a copy or a facsimile. Where's the note? They don't have it because they sold it. The minute he took the loan, not the loan, the minute you signed on the finance agreement, Wells Fargo or whatever bank you have, Deutsch or Swiss, or doesn't matter. The minute you signed your signature, you created the credit. The Fed Reserve that same day gave that bank, Wells Fargo, whoever, $4 million cash money credit. So your debt was relinquished on that house the day you signed it. Then they take your signature and sell it as a bond, okay? And that goes into derivatives, and they take the paper of your house, okay? And they sell that to Bob's insurance company because he's going to insure that mortgage. Then Bob sells it to whoever, and they sell it 9 times fiat, and that's legal to do. A corporate terminology is legal, but it's not lawful. So you're going to destroy all their presumptions and arguments. They're presuming you're stupid, that you don't know, that they're just assignees. They're just assigning you credit. Okay, so now you just blew them out of the water because they're coming into court as grantors, and that's statutory fraud. They didn't grant you anything, buddy. You know, but that's that. The only people that can bring you to court or harm you is somebody that granted you something or somebody that you harmed. If you didn't harm them, and you've already proven you didn't harm them because they didn't grant you anything. So there's no harm there.
Let me go through something here. A case that I'm looking at right now, filed in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. And this is a civil complaint that states in the complaint, quote, plaintiff is the owner of certain credit account hereafter, quote, the account. By virtue of the assignment of the account as set forth in the records maintained on plaintiff's behalf, as a result of the settlement, as a result of the assignment, plaintiff now holds all rights, title, and interest in and to the account. Records further reflect that defendant entered into a credit agreement for the above-named bank, we won't name them, account being number XXX, on it goes, and used or authorized the use of the account to obtain goods and or services and or cash advances. Based upon the review of records kept on behalf of plaintiff, the last payment posted on the account was, and it gives a date of 2/21/2014. The account shows that the defendant owed a balance of, we'll just say, X number of dollars set on 2015-04-07. And then it is certified by the signature of a plaintiff or authorized agent.
Okay. Run through that one more time for me, if you don't mind.
The meaning of the matter is it's an assignment. It is an assignment of rights. Okay. It's a credit company. It is a collection agency that has purchased. It says title and interest in and to the account.
Right. Yeah, they're just assigning you something. So they have no actual interest. In other words, I'm glad you brought this up. So who would have actual interest? Okay. The person that granted the property, that granted the house, that granted the skyscraper. Okay, in other words, it was in physical possession of it, and now through an attorney, move physical possession over to you. That's the person that needs to be in court bringing you in for whatever reason, not some attorney saying, well, we're the ones that assigned the credit. They have no actual interest in the whole thing. So that's why you get them to shut up and say, if you can't put somebody on the stand that says, you know, I harmed you, Trinzi V. Pagliaro, competent witness must take the stand. The statements by the prosecution are not sufficient for summary judgment. That's the end of them right there. And you know, of course, you can put together a whole, you know, armory of, you know, of law just out of Blackstones and Sir William Blackstone and Bouviers. But people have to get around this thing. Okay, let me explain to you like this, Randy. If I sell you a car, but your dad loaned you the money, in other words, if I sell you a car and I'll say, well, Randy, I'll sell you my minivan. It's kind of old and has about 100,000 miles on it. And you say, okay, I got to borrow the money. Well, the person loaning you the money wouldn't be the issue. If I'm waiting for the money back, you know, you got my van and you use a third party. You understand? To pay me. Well, the third party isn't the one that should be suing you. It should be me. Because I sold you my van, and now you're having, you're making payments through your father, and I'm getting payments back to me. I'm the guy that actually owns all the Ford cars, okay? I own all the Ford cars. This third party guy, he's going to assign credit so people can get my cars. You need to deal with the actual person that has actual interest on physical property. Credit's nothing. That's a civil issue, and the courts are only supposed to hear tort claims. Courts aren't supposed to hear civil. Not when it, you know. So you got to go after him as a. I'm trying to remember that guy's name. Because they're acting like they're the grantors. They granted you something that they have actual interest in. Well, they don't. Because they sold the note. This is so important part. They sold the note of the house to another company, and they've already been paid in full. That's why you need to see the note, the original note.
Okay, that's where I was going with this. Because they're claiming plaintiff is the owner of a certain credit account by virtue of the assignment of the account as set forth in the records maintained on the plaintiff's behalf. Now, that's convoluted enough right there, but basically what it's saying is we have bought a credit instrument, and it has been assigned to us, and it is set forth in the records maintained on the credit collection agency's behalf. It doesn't tell me that they have an original wet ink copy of any kind of contract, that they can certify the signatories of the original contract, or that they can verify and validate any such contract if it did even in fact exist. And you know, right. You and I both know how credit cards work. I mean, we understand that people were basically inured into taking out credit cards with mail mail order campaigns. Many people signed up online, never signed a single document. It was just digits in a computer, and boom, there they are. And then they began running a credit on them.
Yeah, it's not a lawful contract, dude. It's unilateral. Unilateral contracts are void ab initio. They're void from their inception. They're irrelevant. So if they're trying to harm you, I don't go to court, okay? I just don't go to court. I'm past that brainwashing. So I wait till they go against me, and then I file under oath or affirmation an affidavit of how they damaged me. And the way I file papers, it's, I'm the law. So that the inferior court, the U.S. District Court, will have to do what I say, because I just handed them a court order. And if they should violate that court order, they're guilty of criminal contempt. That's how I deal with these kind of idiots. Let them do whatever they want. Have a summary judgment hearing and all this garbage, because they don't realize who they just mess with. Their presumption is that I'm Joe Sixpack with a third grade education, and, I text message people all day or whatever. That's their presumption. Boy, are they going to be shocked when they find out their presumption was wrong, So, because if you know how to file those papers, the court must do as you ask, because you're a man. People can't get that in their head because they're all brainwashed, they're persons, and that they're citizens, and all this other stuff. The 14th Amendment solely pertains, to government entities, period. It doesn't pertain to the people, small p. The 14th Amendment only pertains to officials. And it even said so right in the 14th Amendment. And then in 1871, they walked out of those positions even and became even a lower form of existence, and took a subservient position because they were now corporate. And if you take a searchable Bible and type in the name person or persons, God is no respecter of persons. So I don't want to be a person. It sounds complicated, but it's really not. Any contract by Bouvier's, by Sir William Blackstone, must have two signatures, two living men or women taking responsibility. They don't have that. They don't have jack diddly squat. Now, if they're coming against your all capital letter name, you do your acknowledgement again. The same way I told you the acknowledgement earlier. Go to write it out neatly, A colon, A man, semicolon, Stephen John, semicolon. Semicolons are very important in the common law and in Blackstone's and Bouvier's. Miller, semicolon. Believe that. Anybody bringing a charge against my property, known as Stephen John Miller in all capital letters, must be sworn in under oath or affirmation with a proper affidavit with two witnesses, or this should be discharged post haste upon receiving this document. Thank you, amen, Stephen John, semicolon, Miller, semicolon. Thumbprint it and initial it, and now after the notary certifies it, go to her boss, the clerk of the court. It'll take her a half hour to figure out what you're trying to do, because that's how powerful this stuff is. Then she'll stamp it. Now you are the tribunal. You are the tribunal. The court must do as you ask. If they can't give you one, they have to give you the other. So guess what? Since no living man is going to take the stand under oath or affirmation with two witnesses, they're going to discharge it. It applies for corporate, it applies for tickets, it applies for anything. Unless it's a tort, like I said, if it's a tort, which means, you were drinking alcohol and broadsided a family full of a car full of children, then you're in big ass trouble. That's different. That falls under Article 3.
No, and this is the reason why I'm asking a lot of different questions. I'm asking the same questions over and over again because I want to frame them in a way that gives you the opportunity to fully unpack this, Stephen. I guess we can place this recording today under the heading of basically discharging, a discharge of debts, discharge of any liabilities, because and I think this is so under-discussed and has been overcomplicated by so many people out there in the Patriot movement who have gone out and done all these harebrained scheme things, that I just want to, you know, I kind of want you to boil it down to its essentials as much as possible. So my next question is, where, if at all, in any of this, does UCC come into it? That's a uniform commercial code.
It doesn't, because I'll tell you why. It doesn't. UCC doesn't pertain to me. I'm a man. The key word they're misconstruing in UCC is commercial. I don't want anything to do with anything commercial. So people get carried away on this. Oh, I got my UCC filing and form number one, and I'm exempt and all this stuff. It's like, no, you're not. You're still a slave. And now you're going to say, well, I don't want to have a standing under the 14th Amendment. I don't want a standing under civil rights. I don't want any, you know, 42 U.S. Code Section 1983 civil rights hearings. I don't want any part of any of that stuff. So they'll say, okay, we're going to put you in jail. You're now out of society. You got your wish. That's what they're going to do to you. Don't use any of their codes unless there's a comparison. So I'm putting the codes into a piece of paper for court. It's always with the Latin comparison.
Right.
I'm just comparing my... Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I would never use any of their forms because that puts you into their society. And if you're using their society, you know, by using their forms and their lingo and all their nonsense, they can just throw your butt in jail and say, okay, you're no longer part of society now. Let us know when you want to rejoin. That's what they're going to tell you. You know, cause they know what they're doing. So you got to stay, you got to become your own tribunal. Okay. Your own common law court of record tribunal. That's what you're doing when you do the acknowledgement, have it certified, go to the notary's boss. These are the same offices of the Supreme Court, same identical offices. When you have a notary, you're a Supreme Court. You're just as high as the Supreme Court. Now you're just having her boss certify that that notary is legitimate, and you know. And now you got two stamps. The clerk of the court, guess what? She's also a notary. Okay, so you got two stamps. Those two stamps, that's the power you need to do anything and move against these people without even using an affidavit. Because an affidavit is you're swearing everything's perfectly true. Well, what if you made a mistake in your paperwork? You just committed perjury. Do not use affidavits, ever. I would never use one myself for any reason, because I can confidently write a letter. And I know the definition of words, and I'm very competent in that area. I'm not, you know, the world's foremost expert on anything, but I bet I'm a lot better than any attorney most people ever meet. So that's what I would do. They're suing me over a credit card. You know, I mean, an abatement, that's not even a legal terminology. It just means to suppress just slipped my brain. You can look up abatement. You can attach an abatement, but write it as a man, write it in handwriting. Only a man can handwrite. Nothing is submittable to court in type. If you type it out, they'll throw it out as unintelligible because Black's Law, Bouvier's Law, Blackstone's, Valentine's is really good too. I stick with Blackstone's because that's the book accepted worldwide as the law. So if you use Blackstone's, you're going to win. Okay. Now, when you go before that court, you better have the authority. You remove their authority. You appointed this quasi judge as magistrate. Now he can't sit there and say, "Well, I'm going to postpone this," because only a judge can postpone stuff. Only a judge can reschedule hearings. Magistrate can't. They have to give you remedy right now, today. They don't have because you know you're higher than them. Now you've opened the, as they call it in England, the Queen's Bench, and they're doomed, and they know it. You can say, hey, bring me a cup of coffee, and they'll bring you a cup of coffee. Sugar or cream? That's the difference.
Nice.
Yeah. I'm serious. I'm dead serious. Bring me a cup of coffee, and when you're done, and the magistrate says, okay, well, I find on your behalf, Stephen, because they know better than to call me Mr., I'll say, okay, thank you. And just for the, on the record, for the record, you're fired. I want your, all your material and your junk cleared out of this building by 5 o'clock tonight. And the district attorney, he's fired too. You're both fired. Get out of the building. And tell the stupid bailiff, say, if these guys are out of the building by 5 p.m., I want them both arrested on crimes of perjury against their oath. That's a war crime under the Lieber Code. And I will be back to make sure they're not here tomorrow. And they'll be gone. They'll clear their desks out and leave. I mean, you don't have any power unless your paperwork's correct. It's like, because what I'm doing is I'm bringing my court into their court. And guess what? What's Blackstone say? My court supersedes their court. Common law, small c. People, small p. They are the kings. They created the government. The government didn't create me. Okay, God created man. Man created government. Okay, government created persons and fictions. Okay, so who's the supreme power? Well, it would be God, if that's the way you want to believe. That's the way I kind of believe. And then man. So anybody under man is under you. It's that simple. If you have a charge against you, the easy way to get rid of the charge, don't file any paperwork or nothing, okay? Let's say it's some statutory BS, and 99% of the time it is, because you didn't hurt anybody. So you got pulled over, and they charged you with, impeding traffic, what's another common one they like to use against people just for talking? Obstruction of justice, okay?
Of justice, interfering with police duties, they've got a whole bunch of them.
Yeah, you're familiar with that, right? And, so all you do is you take the charge home, okay? You got 3 days to deal with it, right? And you look up the statutes, because they write it on there. They handwrite it, and it's like 00.102 or whatever. Look all that stuff up. And it'll tell you the remedy. And guess what? It doesn't. Let me explain it to you like this. The law applies to everyone. Everyone. Okay. A living person or a living man or whatever. It applies to everyone. But when you go for application, you'll find that it doesn't apply to you. Okay. It can't be applied to you. So you got to pull this. So you just call it district attorney. I say, hey, I just read this statute. It doesn't apply to me. And I'm not going to play games with you guys or mess around. You either discharge this and you file the motion, or I'm suing you for malicious prosecution in federal court. 98% of the time, he's going to call you back and say, yeah, you're right. Sorry about that. And that'll be the end of the case with a phone call. I mentioned Black's Law, Doctrine of Exhaustion, the Administrative Remedy, and Bouvier's and Blackstone's. Be armed. They call them. Because you're exhausting it on the private side, and according to Black's Law, Doctrine of Exhaustion of Administrative Remedy, which most judges go by, the court cannot hear anything when it can be administrated in a private side administrative remedy. So if you're trying to, remedy this, and you say, this doesn't apply to me, this statute, because it says persons. I'm not a person. Okay? The DA is going to wiggle out of that because he doesn't want to be sued for malicious prosecution. And believe me, you'll win. Now, if he hums and haws, say, listen, I'm going to file administratively with the governor, the attorney general, the mayor, etc., administrative remedy, and have you sanctioned. And then I'm going to file an SF tort form 95 federal tort claim against you with the sergeant at arms. So call me back when you've discharged this, and you put the motion to dismiss in. Discharge. Thank you. And guess what? Discharge it, I would say, almost every time. Okay, what's the charge? $120 for impeding, $250 for obstruction. Do they want to, lose their job and their bond through Fidelity when you call the Securities Exchange Commission and let them know this guy's under administrative review and you're doing a forensic administrative investigation on this guy? No, he doesn't want that. But it's also words and being competent and the use of words, and because that's what scares these attorneys and judges and these other people, is when you're extremely good with words and you can back them up. that scares the hell out of them. But if you sound like an idiot, you'll be treated as such. If you go in there with your rap hat on sideways and a, you know, Run Jay-Z t-shirt or whatever, you're just going to be treated like the fool you are. Because these guys are, you know, orders of magnitude more educated than those kind of people. These little rap artists and the people that believe Judge Judy's real, you know. If Judge Judy ever yelled at me, yeah. But of course, these people are stupid enough to put themselves in front of a person calling themselves
right,
a judge.
Exactly, so. Yeah. Of course, yeah, Judge Judy. Well, you know, it sounds good. It's entertainment. That's all that is. That's just entertainment.
That's all that is. Yeah, it's funny, but... yeah, like Judge Wapner, I learned a lot from Judge Wapner, and he was actually a pretty nice guy, I thought, but that gets into jurisdiction issues, you know. They have jurisdiction as soon as they read the complaints. Okay, everybody's been sworn in, he read the complaints, he has jurisdiction. Now, he doesn't have your personal jurisdiction yet, so remember that. Remember that case with Microsoft and Intel?
Yeah, yeah.
How did Intel win and Microsoft got jabbed, you know? I'll tell you how. Because, you know, they weren't in commerce. And the presumption is always commercial activity. Well, if I'm a company and I'm doing business with the general public, that's not commerce. That's not even interstate commerce. That's just free enterprise. And that's how Intel walked on that deal. And Microsoft... they had their own defense, which didn't even, touch on commerce or interstate commerce or free enterprise. And they had to, you know, they were destroyed under the Sherman Antitrust Act. Okay. So, and all they needed to do was use the same defense as Intel. Say, hey, we're not commercial. We're not interstate commerce or commerce between two states, or we're just free enterprise. So much for your antitrust lawsuit under the Sherman Act, right? So that's how that, you know, so knowing the law really pays, you know, and knowing the statutory fraud, the congressional records, none of the codes were ever passed into law, period. Both houses need to, if any law has to be passed by both houses. Why didn't they pass them by both houses? Because the Bar Association, they took 15 statutes at large, they took the public law, which is in big scrolls, like, you know, like the Ten Commandments, you'd imagine is in a big scroll or something, but it took all these laws called public law and big scrolls, and they just took little snippets out of it and created codes. But what they did to defraud the people, they didn't take the remedy out of the public law, because it's in that scroll too. They just took snippets out and created codes. All computer, not really computerized, I mean, back then when they did it, but okay, and that's where you get the codes, and that's why both houses wouldn't pass it, because it was a huge volume of BS, and they weren't going to pass it against their own voters. And but knowing that is only going to help you if you follow the other directions first, like putting your acknowledgement before the court, you know, and telling them I'm the boss here, you know. Bring me some coffee, and I don't want Nutrasweet, I want sugar. You know, because that's the power of law. And it all started with the common law. The common law is the law of reason. It's the unwritten law of reason. That's all common law is. Okay. And the statutes, according to Blackstone's, were created to bring out the not the errors, but what's the other word, Randy? He said the statutes were created to bring out the,
deficiencies.
Yeah.
Deficiencies is the word. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So they did that basically so they could use the common law to screw everybody over, you know, and then try to argue it's lawful and it's not lawful. It's so simple. Did you harm anybody? No. Okay, well, your credit should be affected. I'll give you that. But to take somebody's home away and pose as a grantor when all you did was assign credit, okay, well, that's no excuse to take somebody's home away. How much money does the Fed Reserve give you on my signature? Since I signed it, I created the credit. So you didn't grant me any credit. You technically didn't even assign me any credit because you used my signature. So you're committing fraud upon the court.
You know,
the original note. Yeah.
This is the hardest thing to educate the public on. And I will admit, I stumbled over this concept for years until I finally grasped the idea of how credit was originated, how the banks are able to create, quote, money out of nothing. Well, they're not creating money out of nothing. They're using a system that was outlined in the House Joint Resolution 1933, which basically attached the birth certificate and assigned it a value,
right,
which is then monetized on the world system and sold off as bonds, debt bonds, in order to continue to finance what is called the debt of the American people, which is actually, when you read the statutes and regulations, the debt of the United States government.
It's the most marvelous
cluster F I've ever heard in my life, and yet you have to read it and go over the concepts and read it again and then really look at what they're doing to understand how it is that they are able to hold you responsible for this debt. And now the United States, I mean, the zeros behind the numbers, it's not real anymore. Our country is in hundreds of trillions of dollars in debt. So vast that I believe the world debt clock finally just even quit. I don't even think it can keep up anymore.
Yeah.
They froze it. They stopped the damn thing. So, you know, we live in a monstrosity, a Frankensteinian system of bastardized law and compromised morals, and the American people can't seem to wake up to this.
Yeah, like, I'll give you an example. I'm not trying to cut my father down or nothing, but, you know, he comes from that totally brainwashed government's god 1940s generation. And he goes, well, son, don't you believe you don't think we need police? And I said, well, no, I don't. I think that's, we're turning our responsibility for behaving like adults over to other people. And when you do that, eventually those other people will end up becoming your worst nightmare. And that's what's going on, okay? So no, we don't need police, we don't need judges, we don't need courts, we don't need mayors and constables and county commissioners, etc. Fill out the list of persons, okay? Because when you do that, you've given your responsibility over to other people. So instead of being responsible and saying, you know what, if the law starts at my house, the law starts on my personal property, as long as my family is not harming the neighbor, as long as my family is doing things to uplift the community, and we grow vegetables and we provide inexpensive eggs to our neighbors and we trade and barter, very quickly you would have what's called a utopia, and nobody wants to admit the problem lies within the irresponsibility of all of us, you know. And so once we start taking responsibility and living with honorable intentions, all the problems of the world go away, with the exception of natural disasters, you know.
Agreed.
I'm responsible if my son goes out and rapes somebody. I'm responsible if my daughter turns into a prostitute. Okay? You know why? Because I didn't raise them properly with proper love and education and nutrition and morals and responsibility. And that's what's wrong with the human species worldwide, not just America. The human species is irresponsible, and they're stupid, and they're lazy, complacent, and lackadaisical. I can give you 5,000 words, and that's the problem. And that's why the educated people that went to Harvard can open up a corporate construct that says U.S. District Court on the front, and everybody piles in there to have their problems resolved because they're too damn stupid to resolve their own problems. You know, it's called, under the Constitution, you know, criminal activities dealt with very clearly. Call a firing squad. It's called hanging by the neck until dead. And you do that for one generation, 10 years, roughly a generation.
Absolutely.
There won't be any crime. Yeah. There won't be any crime. Yeah.
Yep.
Because you'll raise Johnny and Susie. Johnny, now, if you ever rob a bank or steal or, then the constitutionally appointed marshal will come out. Forget the sheriff. That's a construct of corporate interest too anymore. And the marshal's going to come and visit you with a piece of rope. String you right up there in the front yard. So, oh, okay. And then once in a while, somebody is going to do something bad. You better take Johnny and Susie and have them watch what happens to them. And all the crying goes away fairly quickly. But as long as you're under LLC, Maritime Admiralty Trust, trust law, contract law, and there's money to be made, meritorious claims, they like crime because there's big money in crime.
Well, the idea of the license was basically to allow someone to do something that was otherwise illegal. So we have driving licenses, and we have casino licenses, and licenses to sell liquor, and all of the things that were illicit in another time, which may or may not be morally exculpatory, but pardon me. Nonetheless, we live in a society where we've legalized vice on every level, and that is the nature of our planet now. We are basically a syndicate of criminal activities.
Yeah, and it's funny that you brought up alcohol licensing because I got all the maxims of law. In fact, if you don't mind, I'd like to go over some of them with you because, you see, if you challenge the court, do you have any jurisdiction over the maxims of law? Guess what the answer is? No. So if you don't have any jurisdiction over the maxims of law, you don't have any jurisdiction, period. And so it's very important to learn the maxims of law. And not learn them, but at least, you know, I keep them in my vehicle. Yeah, I got...
Go
I got
for it, man. Go case. For it.
Yeah. It's funny you brought up alcohol because one of the strongest maxims of law... hold on, let me put on my... reading spectacles here because hold on 1 second. I'm sorry. I have to take my headset off to get my stupid reading glasses on. Okay. These are maxims of law under crime and punishment. Okay. A madman is punished by his madness alone. Okay. These are maxims. The instigator of a crime is worse than he who perpetrates it. Okay. So who instigated the crimes of these wars we're in right now? The American people. It wasn't George Bush. It was the complacency of the American people that instigated these crimes. They allowed these illegal things to go forward until George Bush perpetrated it, right? They who consent to an act and they who do it shall be visited with equal punishment. Okay? So never, ever, never consent to unlawful actions against you. Okay? Never. They who consent to an act and they who do it shall be visited with the equal punishment. Okay, so if you consent to the police doing evil stuff to you, okay, you're also consenting to their criminal behavior, and you're both going to get equal punishment. The cop will get his equal punishment in the end. You're going to get yours right away in jail or probation or whatever. Okay, no one is punished for his thoughts. Okay, that's a maxim. No one is punished for merely thinking of a crime, another maxim. He who has committed iniquity shall not have equity, okay, or equality. But there's one on here in alcohol. I go over these at least once a month just to have a laugh, you know. It's like I'm always prepared to go to court, but I can never get anybody to take me because they're scared of me, I guess. But I help other people all over the country. And I got pulled over by a state trooper in Missouri a couple months ago, and she came flying up on me, Randy. I thought she was going to rear-end me. I kid you not. I was doing 60 in the right-hand lane like I always do. Speed limit was 70, which is commercial. And I thought, what the hell, you know? And then her lights went on. I thought, what the hell? I pulled over. I said, what the hell did you pull me over for? I'm only doing 60. Speed limit 70. I said, are you acting constitutionally today? And like when she was walking up to my van, she seen the scales of justice in the back window. And she said, oh, I was just checking on you to make sure you're all right. I said, yeah, I'm fine. She was okay. Have a nice day. And she went back and got in her car. Didn't have to show her anything. Yeah, that was hilarious, dude. And my friend was in the passenger seat. I was giving a ride to Southern Missouri. He goes, what the hell? How do you get away with everything? I don't understand that. She didn't even want to talk to you, checking to make sure you're all right. Okay. Here's the alcohol one, which is very true. I'm speaking from firsthand knowledge of how alcohol makes me behave. He who sins when drunk shall be punished when sober. Drunkenness, check this out. These are maxims of law. Hold on a minute. Drunkenness both aggravates and the reveal severy crime. And reveal severy crime. Now that's old 1700s talk there. That's probably Blackstone's. A prison is established not for the sake of punishment, but of detention and guarding. Okay. Let me see. Sorry. The ones on alcohol, make me laugh because I've had a long relationship with alcohol. Some of it good, some of it not too good. I guess that was it.
All of a sudden, we're losing it. We're breaking up badly.
Oh, I'm sorry. Well, it's probably because of this. I'm on the internet connection at this gas station, so it periodically cuts off. Any better?
Yeah, the connection just went completely off the wall.
Okay, how are you now?
Okay.
Now? Gonna try me back?
Go ahead and call back in, yeah.
Okay, bye-bye.
Okay.
Under crime and punishment. And that's a good argument. I mean, you can put, now remember, you can put whatever you want in your acknowledgement before the court, okay? Free will act and deed, okay? Well, you're just doing a free will act, okay, in this acknowledgement, saying that anybody bringing a charge against my personal property, that's what they're doing. They're claiming you owe money, okay? Or they're claiming you did something that harmed them. Well, if they're going to do that, it has to be, according to Blackstone's, it has to be under oath or affirmation on an affidavit with two witnesses, or this must be discharged post haste per this order, okay, or however you want to word it. In other words, once you have that kind of power in your paperwork because of the two stamps, they're going to do whatever you ask. And once they realize, well, we can't get a proper oath and affirmation on this, because this guy's going to, do a forensic investigation on this case, so just go ahead and discharge it. And this works. I mean, not one person's used this system, and it's lawful, and failed, not one. Just make sure you're appointing them as magistrate. That's the most important thing, because then that way they can't postpone anything, and they can't reschedule the hearing for another date 6 months down the road to try to exhaust you out, So it's the alterations of any of the maxims of the common law are dangerous, okay? These are all maxims of law and axioms, okay? Black's Law Dictionary, 4th edition, maxims are but attempted general statements of rules of law and are law only to the extent of application and adjudicated cases, okay? So, that's a challenge you could always put on your free will act, on your acknowledgement form, saying that I, a man, Stephen John Miller, believe that this inferior court has no jurisdiction over the maxims of law, therefore has no jurisdiction whatsoever, and so forth. Then you start seeing how I form my documents. Of course, now my document has two stamps on it, so I am the court of records, the tribunal. I'm far superior to anything they could imagine. The judge, I keep saying the judge, but the magistrate knows that. The district attorney probably has a clue, because by the time you get in there with your paperwork, they're already frightened, okay? They just want to give you remedy and get you the hell out of there before everybody else figures out what you're doing, okay? Maxim of law, common sense. When you doubt something, do not act. That's a maxim of law. Okay, and it is a fault to meddle with what does not belong to or does not concern you, okay? Well, geez, don't the police violate that maxim of law every day?
Absolutely.
And, yeah, many men know many things. No one knows everything. That's a maxim of law. I kind of apply that one to myself every day. One is not present unless he understands. And that goes back to Black's Law, that, somebody must understand the charge before you can hold them accountable. That's why they always ask you. You're being charged with, Missouri Revised Statute 001.725. Do you understand? Okay, well, once you say you understand, guess what? You're now present. you're now you're there to be dealt with. So, he who questions well learns well. Okay, and the problem in America, Randy, is people don't question anything, and all they can do is regurgitate television and regurgitate theology they learned from some church idiot and regurgitate law they learned on Fox News, right? But they don't learn anything. Whatever is done in excess is prohibited by law. Okay, and that goes back to the alcohol I was laughing about earlier, because I've done that most of my life. I have an excessive personality. I mean, my music and everything. Okay, no one is bound to give information about things he is ignorant of, but everyone is bound to know that which he gives information about. Okay, that pertains to me too, you know, and anybody that's trying to teach the general public what they've learned. Okay, so I'm not an expert teacher, if you will, because that goes into academia and violations of the 13th Amendment under titles of nobility. But I teach what I know, and I can back up what I know. Okay. But then I go back to the maxim right above it that says many men know many things, but no one knows everything. Okay. So, but the information I do give out, I'm bound to know that of which information is about. So I do the best I can. So anybody can email me. No man is bound to have foreknowledge of a divine or future event. Okay, that's a no-brainer.
Yeah.
No one is bound to arm his adversary. Okay, now this is Fifth Amendment stuff right here, right? No one is bound to arm his adversary. Well, what is it when you get pulled over? That's a total violation of all your rights, Fourth Amendment and Fifth Amendment. Okay, and then if you try to talk, then they tell you, well, I'm not here to have an argument. I'm just here to do my job. Well, now he's violating your First Amendment right. So, and I use this against them when they pull me over. So, wait a minute. I have a First Amendment right to speak. So, when I'm done speaking, then you may speak. That's what I tell them. If they interrupt me, say, if you're going to keep interrupting me, you need to turn me loose on my way, brother. You know? So, I'm not going to let them have a word edgewise until I'm done speaking. That's my First Amendment right. Use it when you get pulled over. Saying, you know, you just pulled me over, you declared an emergency, violation of the Emergency Motor Vehicle Code. Now you're demanding all kinds of documents and demanding that I, interact with you. I don't want to interact with you. Let me talk first, my First Amendment right. When I'm done speaking, then you may speak. Okay, and I really do that. And I'll get 5 minutes into my little speech, and they'll just walk away from the window and give up. Because, you know, they're coming against a guy intellectually unarmed, and I have a whole, armory right here in my front seat. So anyway, maxims of law, consent and contracts. Consent makes the law. A contract is a law between the parties, which can acquire force only by consent. You were just talking about credit cards. Okay, well, this is a good maxim of law. Consent makes the law. A contract is a law between the parties. Okay. Well, who are these gentlemen speaking? These attorneys. Say, can I see their signature on some kind of a consensual contract between myself and them? Otherwise, they need to take the stand as a hostile witness, and I have the subpoena right here. Okay. And so that's why they don't have permission to talk past opening statements. Consent makes the law. The terms of a contract, lawful in its purpose, constitute the law as between the parties. These are very important maxims, in my opinion, for that kind of contractual.
Absolutely.
And lack of contract. To him consenting, no injury is done. He who consents cannot receive an injury. So I'll give you an example. If somebody consents to your charity, Randy, and you're being charitable and kind, then all of a sudden they turn against you, and that happens to me all the time. Well, they consented to my charity, and therefore they also consented to my human iniquities, okay? So they have nothing. And that's why you want to put people like that on the stand as a hostile witness, just to prove everything they're doing is retaliatory and without merit. And like that contract you read me, the credit card contract. Well, I mean, if you read that, it's so parenthetical, you know, it's very parenthetical. It's superfluous as far as, you know, it repeats the same memes over and over again. It's all superfluous memes. It's repeating itself, you know. It'll say things several different ways, but it's basically saying the same thing, you know. That's superfluous. You know, extraneous, same kind of thing, extraneous. So I try to use these words so maybe people will look them up. I know you know all these words because I learned a lot of these words from you. I'm just being honest. When you did that show on law with George Ann Hughes that time, man, I couldn't believe the stuff you knew about history and law. It just blew my mind.
Yeah, but you know, Steve, you know, here's the thing. We're iron sharpening iron. So I learn from you, you learn from me, and we kind of bounce off of each other. And I really appreciate, you know, the last 90 minutes or so have just been anybody can unpack this information and start to put it to use. This isn't just blowing wind into a microphone here. This is hard concepts. So I appreciate that, but I really appreciate what you're breaking down today.
Well, no problem, Randy. And, you know, and I learned it from, you know, I stood on the shoulders of much larger people and myself to learn it. And that's Bill Thornton. Rod Class, I mean, he's a good code guy, but he doesn't know any remedies in court. He's always getting in trouble, and you know, I don't care for that part of him. I've listened to a lot of his talk shows, and I didn't get anything out of it. Him saying, "Ladies and gentlemen, we need to file this stuff in and file that in and point out the fraud." It's like, no, you need to learn the law, Mr. Class. You need to learn the law. You know, I can point out the fraud and anything in 5 minutes. That's not going to help me if I'm dragged before one of their military, you know, administrative tribunals. That's not going to help me. Anything you've told me is not going to help me. It didn't help you in court. The only one helped Rod Class in court was everybody filing his third party interveners, and probably just luck really helped him out. Because that's just plumb stupid. Taking guns into, you know, an area where you're not supposed to. But to me, I can't agree with an individual.
Well, let's get this straight. He's riding around in his Jeep in Washington, D.C. with weapons in the back out of it. Now, the only place on the territorial United States that I'm aware of is that truly comes under the laws of D.C. is D.C. itself. That's the D.C. Organic Act. All these statutes apply directly in D.C. You really don't want to go sticking it in their face inside of their 10 square mile little fiefdom there.
Right. Yeah, they're a little 6.5 square mile, to be politically correct. But yeah, I know you're right. And that's why I don't agree with him. It's because it's like him driving around with blue lights on his Jeep and that says private attorney general, bounty hunter, and all this nonsense. Oh, you're just asking for trouble. And I'm against asking for trouble or, you know, poking my fingers where they don't belong. I just want to live in peace. And to people that want to live in peace and go by the rules as much as possible, then I'm the guy you should be listening to, not Rod Class or Dean Clifford. Spent a year and a half in prison because he's an idiot. You know, I don't care how much code you know or what you think you know. if you're just maliciously doing stupid crap, you're going to end up paying the price for it, you know. And that's what happened with Dean Clifford. I still say the guy is insane. And I predict he'll be back in prison before it gets cold this year. I think he's that dumb. I really do.
He's actually been in and out of prison a couple times since the last time we talked. He keeps getting arrested. You know, I don't consider losing to be winning. When did that happen? Well, I showed up in court and they hauled me off to prison. Look how brave I am. You know something? Winning is winning. Losing is losing. If you're getting locked up, you're losing.
Yep. Yeah, he didn't even go by any of the maxims of law, Dean Clifford. He just said, what did he say? So it was really stupid what he said to the judges or the magistrates there in Canada, which is very similar to Britain, okay, Great Britain. Because you have several magistrates, you know, that preside over whatever case, and he kept saying, he just kept talking incoherently and foolishly, and you know, and now he's on parole, you know, and he probably violated his parole, is why he's been back in. But I just warn people against guys like him. And I don't think the guy is playing with a full deck. He had a wife and a wonderful construction company. But you can't have an attitude I don't know. I can't even describe these kind of people. Drive around in it.
You know, there's a certain wisdom that comes with all of the law. And you and I've talked about this before. You got to pick your battles based on principle and practicality. I guess somebody could argue, okay, I have tags on the back of my car. Is that an adhesion contract to commerce?
Oh, you're asking me?
Yeah.
No. You're doing that to avoid any potential controversy with a run-amok, out-of-control government. That's called being wise.
No, the government, you know, my Commonwealth here in Pennsylvania says that I need to have some sort of identification. I have a driver's license. Does that mean that I've agreed that I am in commerce when I plainly am not in commerce, when I'm driving my private passenger car in traffic? I don't have a meter inside of it. I'm not hauling any freight. So I think what happened with the Patriot Movement, and I knew people like this, they got embroiled in these silly battles over driver's licenses and tags, and they forgot that the bigger principle lie in the intent of the law and in the application of the law pursuant to the particular circumstance. Just tell me if I'm wrong about that.
No, you're 100% accurate. And I look at, I can't even mention all the names, Kate Agaya or Kevin. This is a guy that went totally, you know, ipso facto nuts, and almost got his own family killed, and you can't have dump the paper or whatever, dump the name, and say, you know, you keep your name, just learn how to administrate it. That's that simple. And that would have been so much more simple than ruining all your friendships, and, you know, it's just, you learn how to administrate your property. Nobody has the right to administrate or tender your property without your permission. It's that simple. The all capital letter name and canon law are under the Vatican or whatever. Now it's going to slip my mind. I'm sorry, but the all capital letter name is your
straw man.
Well, that, yeah, the straw man name in law, that's called your the Holy See. It's because you're being administered under the Holy See, and that's your. I'll think of it, Randy. I'm going to keep on the subject matter. But these things are all in law. That no, until you give somebody permission to administrate that property, that's your property. That's called your. I'm thinking of the 6209 IRS manual under gifted estate tax. That's a whole other show.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, and we could get into that because any tax you're filing, you should, you know, file an affidavit of I don't like to use a letter of mistake in fact, because you don't have to pay tax anything under 300. I think it's 660,000. That's called the gifted estate tax. So anything under that amount, you don't have to file, but you have to read the manual 6209, and that'll explain it to you. But see, so the law is there, but because the people are ignorant to the law, they file these forms, like your 10W40. I haven't done
The 10-1040. Yeah, 1040.
Yeah.
I haven't either.
Do that. Yeah.
No, I haven't either. I haven't filed one of those critters in over 25 years. So I don't know.
Yeah, me neither. And
And people will go, well, how are you walking around? I've had people ask me, well, how are you walking around? Why are you free? And I'm like, you know, you have to use wisdom in these things. I don't go around sticking it in people's face. Everybody has a moral principle that they stand on, and that's basically how I arrived at non-filer, was just basically, I can't sign this under, they're forcing you to sign a document under penalty of perjury. They're forcing you to sign it under penalty of perjury. I looked it up. I think that's called duress. I think that makes the document null and void.
Right, right. Yep. And not only that, it's they're forcing you to compel, and the Virginia Supreme Court ruled that nobody can be forced to compel. That's rule, I believe, 7 B, or I think it falls under. You can look it up. Virginia Supreme Court. Nobody can be forced to compel, especially when it comes to the abrogation of rights, which, you know, is void ab initio. So anytime you find something that's trying to force you to compel, that would be completely unlawful. They can't do it. They can't say, you have to have this. Like, no, I don't have to have it. I'm not over 10,001 pounds. I don't need a license. You better read the law, buddy. Ignorance of the law is no excuse, because the general public thinks they have a driver's license. They don't. Get your driver's license out of your wallet and look where it says endorsements. Do you see any endorsements? No, that's not a driver's license. That's just a state ID. All that is.
Exactly. Yeah. Stephen, we're bumping up on the 2-hour mark here, and I want to kind of keep it at that. Okay. So we baited the hook for some future shows. We covered a lot of good material today on this show. Let people know about your activities, how they can find you. I know you have a YouTube channel. You have an email address for people who want to contact you. You do certain, shall we say, types of consulting work that are private of nature. So let people know how they can reach out.
Yeah, if you need help, I don't like to use the word advice because everybody's brainwashed to think, you know, oh, you can't give legal advice, and I really don't. I educate people. What you do with that education is, you know, solely your, you know, what you want to do and research what I teach. But I'm not Dean Clifford. I don't advocate any radical anything. You should try to stay as legal as possible, because that's the society you live in, and you want to live comfortably so just learn how to administrate your all capital letter name. And that's your landed estate. It's called in law. It just came to me. That's your landed estate, according to the Vatican. So that's how you can do business within our society, is with that all capital letter name, a landed estate under the Holy See. Anybody?
S-E-E.
I'm sorry.
That's the eye in the sky, by the way, the Holy See.
Yep. And so remember my email address, and then we can get in touch. I do work by donation and only. And so, like, if you want to spend a lot of time with me and me sending you information, and, you know, you'd have to send me some kind of a donation. Otherwise, it's just not worth my time, because I get a lot of emails. And I'm pretty picky. I pick and choose, you know, what works for me and my dog. Sorry, nothing personal. Because I have a lot of losers, you know, trying to get out of trouble that probably deserve to be in trouble, and I'm not going to help those kind of people. If you're legitimately innocent, you're a victim of some, bureaucrat, I'll help you the best of my knowledge, and that's all I can do. But the minimum requirement is $100 donation, and I'll give you the address where to send it and all that out west here. And Steven 64, S-T-E-V-E-N, 64, at Hushmail, H-U-S-H-M-A-I-L, Hushmail.com. Steven 64, Hushmail.com. Then we can exchange numbers and whatever else. And I can tell a fraud email when I get one, and I get a lot of them. It's total fraud and a joke, and I'm not going to be stupid enough to reply to you, so don't even try. I'll delete it and block sender. That's what I do probably 1,000 times a month. But anyway, I appreciate it, Randy. And, we get together again sometime.
We will.
And we'll be getting more into depth on what I've learned about the IRS, what I've learned about international law and all the other stuff that's kind of pertinent to what's going on in our modern society. So,
very good, right, my God friend. Absolutely. Stephen John Miller. You can
God bless you.
You can find him on YouTube. Give him your YouTube channel.
It's just Stephen, J-U-S-T.
There you go.
And a space, and then Stephen with a P-H, S-T-E-P, as in Paul, S-T-E-P-H-E-N, just Stephen.
There you go.
All right.
Stephen J. Miller. Miller on Law. This is Off Planet Radio. I'm Randy Moggins. The truth is out there. It's inside the law. Find it. We'll be back again very soon.
You are listening to Off Planet Radio at offplanetradio.com.